concept of the green economy emerges in the last years, in the context of the upcoming Rio conference, Rio Plus 20 conference next June in Rio de Janeiro, which is the 20 years conference of the conference in 92 on environment and development. And in the last 20 years, we talked very much about sustainable development. And obviously, sustainable development failed. The climate change convention is in crisis. The biodiversity convention is in crisis. And my impression is that now the global elites, the political elites, the economic elites are looking for a new concept. And this is the concept of a green economy. I think that we should evaluate the concept very critically, because the green economy means, in the midst of the financial crisis, the economic crisis, to look, to search for new opportunities for investment, for capital accumulation, to make capitalism work. And the green economy means, if we go to the documents now of the UNEP, the Environmental Programme of the United Nations, the many, many documents from the World Bank, from think tanks, they really try to reconcile now, out of the economic crisis, growth and the environment. This is the old idea of sustainable development, to reconcile growth and the appropriation of environment. They don't talk about the destruction of the environment. They don't talk about the failure of international politics. They don't talk about the growth all over the world under the rules of capital. So this is the reason why we should be very critical. The dynamics which are taking place under the green economy is really what I would call the financialization of nature. That now over-accumulated capital, which is in the financial markets, is further going into nature. If we think about agrofuels, yeah, the investment into agrofuels, the investment into infrastructure, the investment into the more exploitation of oil, of gas, of mining in Latin America and Africa and Asia and Eastern Europe. So the green economy is not just a word, it's not just a talk, but it's a practice. It's a capitalist practice. And what they try to do in Rio next year, and now in the preparatory conferences, to make this concept of a green economy like a good solution to the crisis, to the ecological crisis, to the financial crisis, to the economic crisis, but in fact, it's a new round of capitalist accumulation. And this is the reason why we should be very critical. Our counter concept should be a profound socio-ecological transformation and not green economy. A socio-ecological transformation which really means to develop the relationship between society and nature and the relationships in society, not under capital's rule, not under capitalist relations, but to enhance a solidarity economy, to enhance the public sector, to enhance real sustainability. That it's not destroying nature, but the new forms to appropriate nature, but in a more sustainable way. And I don't see it at all under the heading of a green economy. And this is the reason why we need counter concepts. My proposal would be socio-ecological transformation, but there are other concepts like solidarity economy, like strong sustainability and others. Here in the workshop at ENA, we discussed dominant concepts in Europe, and we discussed also the experiences in Africa and in Latin America. And I think what we should consider is to link our debates in Europe beyond growth to criticize the forms of capitalist growth with the resource-based economy in the global south, mainly in Africa and Latin America. And to bring the struggles together there against extractivism, against developmentalism, against a model of economic development in Brazil, in Ecuador, in so many countries, even the progressive governments gain the opportunity to distribute for distributive politics, for social politics, because they are exploiting nature. So what we have to counter is that even the progressive forces in Latin America are exploiting nature under the heading of developmentalism, and to sell their goods, their natural resources, their oil, their gas, their minerals to the world market. And I think this is the point where we can link the struggles, our struggles against capitalist production, against capital consumption, which needs these resources from the global south, from Latin America, with the struggles in Latin America which oppose these resource-intensive model of development, which means agrofuels, oil, gas, minerals, and so on. So what we need in Europe is to enhance our perspective towards the global south. What is the basis of our mode of development, of the capitalist mode of development? And also that the struggles in the south understand what are here the struggles and the forms in the north to counter this model. That for people in Latin America and in Africa, it's not just imperialism, it's not just capitalism, but it's also the everyday lives of many people, of the middle class people, of the upper class people here, which are promoting and sustaining these very damaging capitalist mode of production and development. I think this is a step we need to take, because the debates and the struggles are actually not very linked. And my proposal is to link them together: post-extractivism, alternatives in the global south against this extractivist politics, and our radical politics to change the mode of production, the mode of consumption. And I think this is the core when I talk about socio-ecological transformation. If we talk about green economy, we also have to understand why a capitalist mode of production, which is not at all sustainable, is reproducing itself in the everyday life of people. I call it, with a colleague of mine, the imperial mode of living. And the imperial mode of living does not mean that the people in the first world or the global middle classes are imperialists, but we have to consider that the unsustainability of our lives, automobility, the consumption of meat, the consumption of electronics, and so on, is deeply inscribed in the everyday practices of people. Sometimes consciously, but mainly unconsciously. People want a car. They need a car because they live in the countryside. So I want to underline, it's a capitalist mode of production. The production norms of mobile phones, of cars, of food production is set under a capitalist rule, but it's inscribed in the everyday life of people. And Antonio Gramsci, Italian theorist and communist activist, called this hegemony. So we try to understand how these unsustainable forms of living and production are inscribed in everyday lives. And this we have to change. And it's not only to change the property of the enterprises, but we have to change the everyday practices of people. This then has to do, of course, with power, but also, of course, with consciousness, but also, of course, with alternatives. That people need alternatives, that they don't need the car, that they don't want the car. We need attractive forms of living with respect to cities, with respect to food, and so on. This is a bit the point we try to understand. And the problem is actually, with this imperial mode of living, the Western way of life, if you like, is that it's universalizing. That obviously for the middle classes in Latin America, in Africa, in Asia, in Eastern Europe, it's enormously attractive to have a car, to consume dairies, to consume meat. And it's not a moral argument. I don't want to say, oh, you should not consume meat, but it's a starting point to rethink the world, to rethink the production and the consumption, which is so unsustainable today. This is a bit the intention of the concept. And it's quite interesting when I presented it recently in Latin America, that obviously it helps the activists there to understand what's going on here, that it's not only imperialism, it's not only capitalism, but it's the everyday practices of people here which are damaging, in a kind, the ways of living there, because there it's extractivism of oil, of gas, of minerals, and so on.